Good evening, everyone. We're here with Charles Mack. I'm just going to read just a brief introduction about Charles Mack. He's a Grammy nominated. Charles Mack was a former bassist for Lucky Peterson and Grammy Award winner James Cotton, right? Charles Mack has shared the stage with a number of accomplished artists in various genres, alternative rock groups, Inflatable Soul, is that right?
Yeah.
Rap group Cypress Hill, blues, R&B, jazz artist Coco Taylor, Buddy Guy, Marcus Miller, Otis Taylor, Shamika Copeland, right? Otis Rush, Maria Modler, and the list goes on and on and on. Okay. So tell me a little bit about yourself, Mac.
Well, I'm originally from Chicago. Been living in Phoenix for about 2 years, and loving the sun, not missing the snow in Chicago. So I know some of my friends in Chicago are probably a little upset about that statement right there. But yeah, youngest of nine, been playing music ever since I was a kid. Started off playing classical music, tuba, trombone, euphonium, and went from that, kind of shifted over to bass guitar,
mm-hmm.
and was kind of forced into singing when it was when I played with the Navy band. So it was one of those things where they didn't have a vocalist at the time,
right.
So they kind of pointed to me and said, "Learn to sing." So that's pretty much me in a nutshell musically.
Right.
I started partner with a person doing a lawn care landscaping here in Arizona, so it's a big job of owning a lawn care company and trying to grow the company within a year.
Mm-hmm. Right. You mentioned that you recently stated that you were returning back to the music scene.
Yeah.
And so you're trying to manage this company and all other things.
Mm-hmm.
How long have you been away from the music scene?
I took about 15 years off.
Mm-hmm.
from playing, and the reason I took the time off was I was taking care of my mother. My mother had gotten sick,
mm-hmm.
and so she had gotten to the point where she couldn't take care of herself. So ended up I was working for the post office as
right.
a mailman,
mm-hmm.
and the worse off her health had gotten, I just completely stopped. I stopped working for the post office. And just took care of her, and took care of her around 2007, 2008, until about 2010 she had passed. And she was actually my biggest
okay.
fan. At 2010, I could not pick up a guitar.
Mm-hmm.
I could not play.
Mm-hmm.
She was my inspiration, so
right.
I couldn't do it.
Great. Leading up to the next question, what inspired you to return this time around?
I think what really inspired me was I started thinking about my mother, started thinking about my father, my sister. They were all musical, especially my father, blues guitar player, which I keep his guitar right next to me.
Mm-hmm.
Just constantly for the past 2 to 3 years, I kept hearing my mother's voice, my father's voice saying, "What are you doing?" So I was getting day job after day job, quitting, getting hired somewhere else. So it was just lost. So hearing that over, and it had just gotten to a point where when I started slowly getting into it, I started meeting a lot of other musicians that were out there, and I started getting that feeling
mm-hmm.
back, which, my soul was completely dead after I buried my mother. But the conversations that I had with the musicians was just really exciting. It was, "Oh man, we're here, then we're over in Nebraska tomorrow, we're playing here at this festival, we're doing this, and we just blah, blah, blah." And it's just, I'm like, man, God, I miss those days.
Yeah.
So, it took a while, but I'd say the biggest motivation was just how the universe kind of of shifted and pointed me in the direction to hear my mother towards him, my father's voice,
mm-hmm.
and the conversations that I had with meeting new musicians.
So you're catching the vibe from everybody else, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Kind of like this pulse coming back again to you.
Exactly.
Cool.
Exactly.
Was the process easier for you to come back this time?
It was kind of, not really, no.
Yeah.
And I think the reason it wasn't is because over time things changed.
Yeah.
We no longer buy CDs.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all web streaming and digital downloads.
Right.
So
right.
The industry's changed and CD sales have dropped drastically.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it's been a matter of the consistency of a fan base.
Mm-hmm.
So 15 years of not performing,
mm-hmm.
the fans that I had were like, oh, I guess he's dead, you know, move on to the next artist,
right.
or so. So I lost my fan base, and it's been really tough trying to build it.
Right.
To build it.
So if people want to see you live and they want to see you digital wise and listen to your music digital wise, how can they contact you or view your music and your art, your work?
Well, there are a few ways, through either my website, charlesmack.net,
mm-hmm.
or iTunes, if you type in my name, or...
you have a Facebook page also?
I have a Facebook, I have Twitter, Twitcher. Instagram, Instaham.
Right.
So, Pinterest and all of the other things, which I have no idea what
they
mean. Okay. So, I'm starting to sound like my father was like, I have no idea why they have it, but I have it. So, yeah.
It's another language like music, right?
Yeah,
yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Right. What are some of the challenges as an artist and a musician that you face as far as finding gigs or venues for gigs?
I think the biggest challenge that I've found is, again, it's the fan base, it's the draw. A lot of venues, they've become a little more savvy with who they bring in, and it's the artist that, the butts to seat ratio.
Right.
So it's not just that, but it's the butts to seats to lips to cups.
Mm-hmm.
So how many people are buying alcohol, how many people are buying food.
Right.
So having that draw, having 100 people that you could say to a club, I've got a fan base, I know I'll at least have 100 people in
mm-hmm.
here.
Right.
So that's, it's been a big change. Trying to think of something else and at this moment.
Okay. Well, we'll go on to our next question. How's that? I know you're doing this again. What would you do different? What did you do differently to come back again this time after 15 years?
I think the biggest thing that I've done differently this time
mm-hmm.
is focus. In the past, I was partially focused, but I was kind of everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. That was the biggest thing. Right after you finish a performance, you have some beautiful ladies that are saying, oh my God, I love the way you play. It's, let's go over here. Or, whatever. Here's some drinks. Here's this. Here's that.
Mm-hmm.
So losing track and losing focus for me back then.
Right.
The dedication, the understanding of not burning a bridge.
Yes.
In the past, getting drunk and, doing whatever is, it's the way to handle yourself and the way we mature into being that professional musician.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
I think those are the things that I'm doing now that were totally different. If I saw myself then,
yes.
I would pull myself aside and say,
mm-hmm.
don't do it!
We're young and foolish,
yeah,
but we really
yeah,
need
yeah,
to thought about
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
You're having fun.
Yeah.
The music scene is, there's always something happening in life.
Mm-hmm.
And you're always on the go, so I totally get it. Now that you come back after 15 years, you're focused, and does your mom, is your mom and dad the inspiration for your focus?
They were. There's some a small snippet of that video clips that I have of my mother and father, so I would constantly watch them, and my mother's song is "You Are My Sunshine." You know, mm-hmm. When she was a kid, she used to get up and sing that all the time. So whenever I feel like I really need to have her there to help me be focused, I would either sing that song mm-hmm. or I'd pick up my father's guitar with my mother's scarf on.
Awesome.
So it's been refreshing, but you know, still a little disheartening to know that she's no longer here, but trying to think optimistically
right.
and, you know, keep that positive vibe going that she's always with me.
Yeah, well, you've got their soul through the things that you have here, which is your dad's guitar and your mom's scarf, right?
Exactly.
And the song that she sings. You told me you have a classical background.
Yeah.
And I was looking at your Facebook page, and I'm like, oh, yes, he does write music.
Mm.
So you write a lot of your compositions that you perform, and what style, what genre is your music? Is it blues, or do you write for other genres?
I kind of write every genre possible.
Awesome.
But what I've been trying to do is kind of blend everything in and try to create a new style of music, kind of a John Mayer-esque, but the next level,
mm-hmm.
or the Lenny Kravitz, but the next level. So
right.
it's that mixture. And writing classical, jazz, rock, pop, funk. It's, you know, trying to ensure that we, you know, still cook the right dish and
right.
put it out there.
Right, right. Now you are going to be performing in California. That's what
yeah.
I heard, right?
Yeah.
So is there a particular you want to share with everyone where you're going to perform in California?
We'll be performing at the Arcadia Blues Club, which is located in the beautiful city of Arcadia, California. So 7:30 to 11:30, we'll be performing. And feel free to come down. That's going to be April 13th. Tip jar will be out, so we accept anything. We won't accept anything less than $100.
Okay, on that note, will you be sharing some of your original stuff, your original work?
I have one song that we may do, and it's the song that I recorded in the past.
Right.
The plan was to do some of the originals for the new album,
mm-hmm.
but been kind of shifting around, changing the band a bit, so kind of have a new drummer,
mm-hmm.
Devin Poole.
Yes,
and,
yes, yes.
Incredible drummer from Hattiesburg, Mississippi. And we have Adrian from Hermosillo, Mexico, and Filthy, which is an incredible guitar player.
Mm-hmm.
So,
great.
Yeah, so it's you know, just making sure right now, just taking that step back and ensuring that the music that's put out there is with the musicians that are going to be with the
mm-hmm.
that are going to be recording and are going to be consistent with the group. So,
right. Fantastic.
So yeah. So
yeah.
That was the reason why we're not doing any of the more current songs.
Right. Yeah. Right. So the focus, the genre that you're particularly going to be playing is blues or a mixture?
Kind of a mixture.
Mm-hmm.
Hendrix, Lenny
yes.
Kravitz, Eric Clapton, B.B. King, Buddy Guy. So it's going to be a mixture. It's, you know, but it'll have our brand, it'll have our stamp on it, that
fantastic.
Funky, bluesy rock.
Your style, you guys'
yeah.
style.
Yeah.
Great. Creativity at
yeah.
its best, right?
Exactly.
Okay, so I've got one question for you. I think, you know, for the young generation, you know, jazz and blues and some of these old classic music, you know, classical music are not out there like hip hop and rap, but, you know, this is something you want
yeah.
out there to bring back all the old school and all the good stuff that we used to listen to when we were
yeah.
kids, right?
Oh, yeah.
Or your parents listened to.
Yeah.
What advice and tip would you give upcoming musicians and artists?
Well, I think if I had my long list, I could completely go down. It's the biggest thing for any artist is to constantly develop your craft.
Mm-hmm.
Be true to your art form.
Mm-hmm.
That's most important. Never try to be another artist. Never try to copy that artist. And just be a clone.
Right.
You can be inspired by that artist. I was inspired by Marcus Miller, John Patitucci, Jaco Pastorius, Ron Carter, and so many bass players.
Mm-hmm.
But I would try to mimic their style to help me develop my identity.
Right.
But I would never try to say, "Oh, I'm this Jaco clone, and I'm just gonna play
right.
you know, this." It's
right.
Always remaining true to the art form is
right.
important.
Right.
Network, network, network. Never burn a bridge.
Mm-hmm.
Never burn a bridge.
Okay.
They always say do things in moderation. So if you're drinking, do it in moderation. So now if you're dating, make sure you have that right person that's with you.
Yes.
And that's a big part of it for any artist.
Mm-hmm.
It's important, especially if you have that significant other.
Mm-hmm.
It's for that significant other to truly be 100% with you.
Yes.
So I've been on the side where I would have the ones that were with you temporarily,
mm-hmm.
and then once a fan would come up and shake your hand, what's that about? Why is that fan shaking your hand?
Right,
I'm signing a CD,
right,
or whatever. So that's important to have a healthy relationship. But it's enjoying life.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to enjoy life, but you got to put the hours in,
yep.
blood, sweat, and tears, into practicing. And you have to constantly practice. You have to hone in on that your craft to be the best that you can be, and then go beyond that, because being the best that you can be creates an ego.
Mm-hmm.
And so once you have that ego, you're lost.
Mm-hmm.
So be as humble as possible.
Right.
Keep moving forward, because right. no matter how big or how great you think you are, there's always
somebody
that's better.
Mm-hmm.
And they may not be in that city,
right.
but they're somewhere in Africa, or they're somewhere in Ireland, or they're somewhere.
Yeah.
So always be humble, be true, and just, you know, don't burn bridges, and keep a good head on your shoulder.
And be authentic. I like that. You
yeah.
said that you can, you know, admire and, you know, learn other people's style, but the fact that you're authentic and then you're creating your own style and developing your own style for yourself, which is really, really worth it, because people love to hear your version of another song, right?
Yeah.
And it's so truthful to you as a person in delivering the music, right?
It is.
Yeah.
It is.
Okay. And so I know you want to travel other countries. I heard you said that you want to travel other countries. Where would you like to go and perform?
Where I would love to go is back to France,
mm-hmm.
one. Back to Japan, China. God, everywhere, really.
Yes.
Was in Africa, did a show in Africa with and a friend of mine, Matthew Scholar.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I can't remember where it was, Tunisia. Performed in Tunisia, so I got a chance to be inspired by, you know, Dizzy, Night in Tunisia. So it's everywhere, because it's, you know, wherever you go, there you are, and the music's there, and you
mm-hmm.
just got to be inspired, so.
Okay, that's Charles Mack for us, and you want to tell us again how we can find you on social networks and wherever we are on
yeah.
digital age?
Yeah, either through charlesmack.net,
mm-hmm.
that's Charles Mack, MACK.net, or Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
I have 2, 3, 4 Facebook accounts, so if you see a guy with a bass guitar, that's me. There's another Charles Mack who had written the father song for August Rush.
Mm-hmm.
He lives in New York.
Okay.
So
you're the Charles Mack here in
yeah,
Phoenix.
Yeah. And the funny thing is, I know the Charles Mack in New York too.
Okay.
You could reach me that way, or type in my name through YouTube. There's always a way to find me. If you call
mm-hmm.
the local police station, they will know how to get in touch with me too. So,
Well, thank you very much. It was wonderful getting to know
right,
you. And I
you.
Hope everybody out there in Facebook and on the media will tune in to Charles Mack live on some of his show, and then send him a friend request or join his Facebook page. Thank you.
Thank you.